This is a production of WKNO Memphis. Production funding for this program is made possible in part by the WKNO Production Fund, the WKNO Endowment Fund, and by viewers like you. Thank you.
You've seen the commercials and you've heard about the issues. But who is Mike McWherter, the Democratic nominee for governor? We'll find out when we visit with Mike and his wife Mary Jane in their Jackson home in a conversation with Mike McWherter, Election Edition. Mike McWherter, the Democratic nominee for governor, is a political newcomer, but he's no stranger to Tennessee politics. We wanted to get to know the son of former Governor Ned McWherter, so we traveled to his home in Jackson for an in-depth conversation about his background and character. Mike McWherter, Democratic nominee for Tennessee's next governor, thank you so much for having us here at your home in Jackson.
Thank you, Vicki. I'm delighted y'all are here. I appreciate you coming.
Now, you and your opponent, Bill Haslam, both come from fathers who are very influential, very famous. First of all, how's your dad doing?
My father turned 79 October 15th. He will be 80 this October 15th. I really plan to have a series of birthday parties for him from one end of the state to the other. He's looking forward to that as well because that'll be right in the throes of the campaign, and there are a lot of people who are very interested in seeing him. He's doing well. A little arthritis in his hip, but for 79 years old, he's doing very well, and he is certainly very engaged in this campaign, and I'm glad of that.
What was it like growing up as the son of Ned McWherter? I mean, you must have some stories.
I have lots of stories. I'm not sure I can tell all of them on TV, but I do have lots of stories. It was a real privilege to grow up as Ned McWherter's son. He was obviously a very committed public servant. He was always interested in the community, so therefore he made sure that we were always involved with the community and community activities. Just a great gentleman. I believe he instilled great values in me. I count myself as being very fortunate to be Ned McWherter's son and to have been raised by him and his value system and what he wants to accomplish. He taught me at an early age that I needed to be very careful about watching my pennies, watching my money, and always conducting myself as a gentleman.
Has he given you any advice for this?
Oh, he's given me lots of advice. We talk on that a daily basis. He's very engaged in the campaign. And, you know, I think one thing he's always told me is, you know, Mike, be yourself. Be truthful. If you're always truthful, you'll never have to back up on any statement that you make anywhere in the state or any time in your life. And I found that that is very good advice, not just for campaigns, but also for just dealing with life in general.
But your family roots are from Weakley County, Union City, Dresden. Tell us about that part of the state.
Well, my family roots are, my father's family is from Weakley County, that is Dresden. My mother's family are from Obion County, that is Union City. They're right next door to each other, and I claim both communities. But I guess because I went to school in Union City, that's where most of my friends were as I was growing up, and still today, that's where I have my associations from high school. So you can tell I'm trying to make sure that I'm being very careful here to claim both communities, because both communities were a big portion of my life growing up.
Mike's childhood in West Tennessee was not perfect. His parents, Ned and Betty Jean Beck McWherter, divorced when he was 4 years old, and there were other difficult transitions still ahead. Now, when you were just 13, your father won a seat in the General Assembly. How did that change things for the family?
Well, it did change things for the family pretty drastically. He was gone to Nashville a good bit. At that point in time, my mother had been diagnosed with cancer, and so she suffered with that for the next 5 years. And it was a tough time. But the bottom line there is, my father's mother and his father played a very central role in my life during that period of time as a teenager. They were very involved with me, and as my grandmother said, she didn't think she was going to get to raise the second generation, but you know, my father was very involved in my life, but he lived right next door to my grandparents, and so I was very fortunate to be able to have that kind of support within the family.
What was that like, living with your grandparents, having them so close to you?
Well, it's really pretty funny because my grandparents lived right next door to my dad. My father's home burned down when I was pretty young, And he lived in the garage apartment behind my grandparents at that point in time. And he had $5,000. He didn't have any insurance. He had $5,000. He told the guy when he got through building the house that he wanted to make sure he had a roof and four walls and a kitchen and a bathroom. Unfortunately, that did not include a floor in my bedroom. And so I didn't get a floor in my bedroom until I was 12 years old. So I did live next door of my grandparents when I was at his house, and I slept in their guest bedroom. And when I was 12, I got a floor in my bedroom. I was very delighted to get that. But that's my father. I mean, he absolutely was not going to go into debt any more so than he needed to at that point in time in his life. And those are lessons I learned growing up with him.
Now, your dad becomes Speaker of the House while you went on and graduated from high school and then went on to Vanderbilt Law School. Was your dad influential in your decisions, or did you make some of those decisions yourself about what you would do?
My father was completely open to wherever I wanted to go to school, and I did choose Vanderbilt because, truthfully, one of the main reasons that my father was up there quite a bit, I had just lost my mother, and I was missing a little bit of that family connection. And I thought Vanderbilt would be a nice mix for me because I could be a little closer to my father. And at the same time, Nashville's a big city, and you can have a little distance as well. So I really enjoyed my Vanderbilt experience. That was a very nice experience for me. I learned a lot. I made a lot of friends who live here in Tennessee and all across the country. And then I started trying to decide what I wanted to do after college and looking at what I wanted to develop in the way of a career. And I decided I would go ahead and apply to law school. And I wound up graduating from Vanderbilt Law School. And my father was very supportive of that as well. Dad is not exactly the biggest fan of lawyers sometimes, but he was happy with me going on to law school. And I practiced law in Nashville for several years, and then I got back involved in business.
And why did you decide to go into business, leaving law school, leaving your law practice?
Vicki, after practicing law for about 4 years, I wanted to get involved in Dad's campaign in 1986, and I did. And I traveled in all 95 counties in that campaign. And of course, he was successful. And what I figured out pretty quickly is you just can't ethically practice law in the capital city of the state where your father's the governor. There are just too many conflicts of interest. And I realized that I didn't want to be in the center of that kind of controversy. I did not want to create a problem for my father or any of my law partners that I would be involved with. So I started really looking for another career, and I got an opportunity to buy a business in Jackson, Tennessee. It was a friend of my father's who had gotten very ill, and he did not have any family involved in the business at that point in time. And he approached me and said, "Mike, I really think you ought to consider buying this business." And I looked at the situation, and I decided, yes.
For those who don't know about your business, what can you tell us about it?
Well, I'm a beverage distributor. I sell Monster Energy drinks, a line of waters, and I'm an Anheuser-Busch distributor. That's the major line that we do sell. So, I consider myself to be a beverage distributor. I'm also a director of a small community bank here in West Tennessee. And the other thing that I think gives me a great insight into industry is I serve on the Jackson Energy Authority Board. That's the local utility here in West Tennessee. We provide everything from wastewater to water to electricity to natural gas, but the most important thing that we're servicing now is a high-speed broadband internet network. And it has been key to maintaining industry in this area and helping to attract industry into this area. I know that for a fact, and I understand how important that is to make sure we have that kind of access all across Tennessee in our rural communities as well as our urban areas. And it's something that we've got to have as we fight unemployment all across this state. You've got to have the infrastructure in place. And I believe I've learned that. I've learned what the capital needs are from being a director on the bank, and I've learned what the infrastructure needs are for industry. I think I know how to put a package together to help attract industry here in this state.
We took a break in the interview to meet Mike's wife, Mary Jane, and get a tour of their Jackson home. This was Mary Jane's first television interview, but you couldn't tell it when we talked to her and Mike about their relationship and family.
How did you two meet?
We met in 1978. We both had the opportunity to be interns for Congressman Ed Jones, who's from Yorkville, Tennessee, and we met in his office, actually.
Now, was it love at first sight?
You know, I've said this many times. It's kind of ironic. When I met Mary Jane, yes, I knew immediately that I wanted to be married to someone like her. Now, I never thought it would be Mary Jane, but I knew from the time I met her, the day I met her, that was somebody I wanted to be married to. And this is a true story. My dad's mother did not live long enough to see us get married. And she was very frustrated because she said, until Mary Jane gets married, Mike is never going to marry. And, you know, and she wasn't sure that we were ever going to get married. And so she shared that. I heard that story after her death. Her friends told me that. She said, we are so glad because we know your grandmother is looking down and knows that y'all finally did get married. But, yes, with me, it was just pretty much love at first sight. I just didn't realize that it was going to be Mary Jane.
Now, what was it about him that attracted you?
I think the first thing I saw was his sense of humor. We just had a lot of fun. There were several interns that summer, and so we all had fun together. The other thing is Mike's very calm. He's a very calming influence, calm in a storm, and he can solve a problem. So all those things attracted to me immediately.
And what was it about her that was attractive to you?
Oh, her personality. I mean, when I walked in the door, and I was the last intern to arrive in that office, and I was getting introduced all around, and just meeting Mary Jane immediately, I knew what a great person she was. And as I got to know her, I understood how kind and how tender-hearted she is. And yes, I mean, she is an infectious personality. She has never met a stranger. She makes everybody feel at home. And people will tell you that she's a great people person.
Now tell us about your wedding. What was the wedding like?
We got married in my home church in Covington, Tennessee. My mother and my sister helped me pick out everything. We had a small wedding, and we got married in the morning, and then had breakfast, basically a brunch afterwards.
You have to remember, at the time, Dad was governor, and we started looking at the guest list, and it was just going to be humongous, and we just decided to really do a very small, intimate wedding with our very closest friends and our family. And even having done that, it was very funny because we were trying to divide up, you know, okay, you can have X number of people and you can have X number of people. I had to borrow some of her people to get all of the family in. So it was a nice wedding. I wouldn't have done it any other way. It was really a very nice setting.
Now I've seen some pictures. Did I see a picture on the mantle of your wedding?
I do believe we still have that one up there. It's been almost 21 years.
Wow. And does it get better?
Oh, without question. Every day.
Good answer.
It's fun with Mary Jane. There's no question about it. But what she's not telling you is that we knew each other for 11 years before we did get married.
What took you so long?
Well, she wouldn't agree to marry me. I finally had to persuade her. But we did. We really became very good friends first. And then, I realized that I was in love with her. And so then it took me a few years to persuade her that she was
That's
in love with me.
That's not true.
Now, in the beginning, what was it like having Ned McWherter as your father-in-law? That had to be frightening.
He's a great, well, I think everybody knows, he's just such a warm, down-to-earth person. It really was not frightening. He's the nicest person around, and really made me feel welcome, and just made me feel at home.
Let me take that question and say this. There is no question my father thinks Mary Jane hung the moon. He says frequently that I overmarried myself. There's no question about it. They have a relationship that any father-in-law and daughter-in-law ought to have, and they get along wonderfully. Dad really leans on Mary Jane for advice about many different things.
The one big advantage I have over everyone else is that I am the mother of his grandchildren, and he does love those grandchildren.
Tell us about Walker and Bess.
Walker's 18. He is at Rhodes College. He is a freshman this year, and he's playing football right now.
And he's going to play baseball.
and he's going to play baseball. And Beth is a senior in high school. She participates in lots of extracurricular activities, including volleyball, basketball, and softball.
Now, what role does religion play in your home? And Mike, how do these values affect you now that you'll be in the public arena?
Well, we are members of the First Presbyterian Church here. Mary Jane has been a deacon in that church. We've been very active there. Mary Jane has taught Sunday school, and well, you ought to be saying
well, Vacation Bible School is one of my favorite things to do. We worked the children and I worked, and Mike was gone a few weeks ago, and the children and I worked the nursery just a very few weeks ago.
Actually, I sat in church. No, I was there. Remember, I was in church. Y'all were running church. I didn't want to be in the nursery. But we've got a wonderful minister here. John White has been a real inspiration to us. He talks to me every week about, you know, Mike, how are you doing? How are you holding up? He's very interested and very supportive. And he's just been a real mentor to me all the way through this race.
Well, Mary Jane, if you become First Lady, what do you see your job as? Where do you want to go with that?
Well, the first thing I want to do is make sure that I am still supportive of my husband and my children. And I've also, while I've been in Jackson these 20 years, I've been very active in a lot of charity organizations. I've been on the board of the Carl Perkins Child Abuse Center, the Red Cross, the March of Dimes. So I've always had an interest in issues affecting children and families. And so I could see myself really trying to do something to benefit those groups.
And Vicki, let me also say this too. Mary Jane's being very modest, but in many ways, as I said, my father relies on her for advice. We were married the last 4 years he was governor. She well understands the task in front of her as serving as First Lady of the state of Tennessee.
What kinds of things do you hope to accomplish as a team, as a couple, once you become the first couple?
Well, I want to get people back to work, and I want to get my programs passed, and it means that I'll have to work very hard with the legislature to do that. That will be my focus. Mary Jane, throughout this whole campaign, has really held down the home front. I have to really brag on her. There are qualities I don't think she ever realized she had. You may know that our business flooded in these recent floods. I haven't been home to see about that at all. Mary Jane has overseen that entire construction project, from buying the furniture to picking out the paint to taking the bids. There's a whole side, a whole business side to Mary Jane, and I'm confident that she'll be running the governor's residence. That is an institution that can be very valuable when you start trying to recruit jobs into the state. I saw how my father used that governor's residence to entertain and to bring people in and to talk to them about why Tennessee is a good place to do business. Mary Jane will make a fabulous First Lady, and she'll run that governor's residence in such a way that it'll be a credit to our state.
Being a part of the state's first family once before, Mike McWherter knows the job description for Tennessee governor. We finished our conversation with questions about his campaign and what he hopes to achieve if elected in November.
We've talked, Mike, about how this is really your first run for public office. Why should Tennesseans vote for a man who has no political experience?
Well, I'll tell you exactly why they ought to. It's very important who succeeds Governor Bredesen. He cannot run again. And Tennessee needs a person who's got business skills to keep this state moving forward. I have those. You know, if you look at what my background is, I'm a small business person. I know what it is to meet a payroll. I know what it is to provide health care benefits and to work those out for the people that are in your company. I know how to build a budget from scratch, and I know how to live within it. Those are skills that you have to be a successful governor. I didn't start my business, I bought it. And when I bought it, I had a lot of debt, and I had to work my way through that for a number of years. I understand the issues that small business people face all across the state. If you look at my opponent, I don't believe he's ever had that kind of experience. His is much more experience of Wall Street. Mine is an experience about Main Street, and that's going to be important because in this economy, it is small business that will lead us to recovery. They did it in 1981, they did it in 1991, and small businesses today are kind of reluctant to be adding people back to the payroll.
So what is your plan?
I really talk about it in a two-part process. You know, Governor Bredesen has endorsed my campaign, and I'm not saying this just because he's endorsed my campaign. He's really embraced our campaign. It's been very helpful, very supportive. But I think he's laid a great foundation in recruiting some major industries into this state. Hemlock, Bakker Chemie, Volkswagen are three, the Nissan headquarters in Middle Tennessee. He's done a great job of recruiting some major industries in here. Now, I think, I don't care where you live in Tennessee, if you live in Obion County or Shelby County or Davidson County, if you're a Tennessee taxpayer, you've got an investment in those companies because we've given them tax incentives and tax credits to come here. Now, I think the way we all get paid back is to actually target the associated companies with those large corporations that have come in here. If they make seat belts, or they make headlights, or they make solar parts, we need to aggressively identify them and recruit those industries into Tennessee because they will want to be located within a day's drive of their customer, their supplier. And we can get those jobs spread all across Tennessee. We've got to work with our education systems to make sure that we're providing the curriculum they'll need to meet those workplace needs. But I want to aggressively, so it'll be a combination of doing this and working with our education system. I want to aggressively go after those. But Vicki, the other thing I talk about as well is having a program of tax incentives and tax cuts for existing small business in this state. It's a model that is proven to work when we have recruited these large industries in here. We can have a similar plan for small business in this state. As a matter of fact, the state of Illinois last year had a program very similar to what I'm talking about. They're giving a $2,500 tax incentive to small businesses that are create for each job they create. Their requirements are that the job pay at least $25,000 a year and that the person stay on the payroll for at least 12 months. And what that does for small business is gives them that incentive to go ahead and start adding people back to their payroll and start to grow their business. When I hear my opponent, who is Bill Haslam, talk about what his plans are, he talks about areas of regional economic development. Well, to me, that's just bureaucracy. And I think what we need is to be much more nimble and have programs that are really addressed to small business because that's where the vast number of jobs are in this state.
You have been all over the state campaigning, and even when you're not campaigning, you've been all over the state. What's been the best part of campaigning? What kinds of things have happened while you've been on the road?
Well, it's pretty amazing. You know, I got to spend some time in all 95 counties when my father ran in 1986. I guess the best part of it is I've traveled around the state, I've had a chance to reconnect with all those people that I saw in my father's campaign. They're still around, they're still active. Many times when I go to an event in a county, they'll be bringing their children or their grandchildren now. But it's been very nice to be able to go out and reconnect. And they all tease me about the fact that I had a whole lot more hair back when my father was running. They said, "Mike, you've lost all your hair." I said, "I know, but maybe I haven't lost my sense. I believe I still understand what we need to move this state forward." So that's been the best part of it for me. I love people. I inherited that quality from my father. I really enjoy traveling the state and visiting with everyone. And we've got a foundation and organization in every county in this state. And I'm really excited to see how enthused they are about this campaign.
Do you find that you're eating a lot of chicken, a lot of things that you normally wouldn't eat because they're like, "Here, Mike, eat"?
I will confess that I have gained 15 pounds, and then I lost 5, and I have found them again. So my goal now, between now and November 2nd, is to make sure I do not gain any more than that.
But when you have any free time at all, which probably doesn't come around too often now, what do you like to do? What's your passion?
I do enjoy playing golf very much. I have not gotten to do much of that during the course of this campaign because in a priority standpoint of how you're going to utilize your time, what time I have outside the campaign I want to spend with my family and not on the golf course. But when things do return to somewhat of normalcy, I will definitely enjoy getting back to my golf game, which is not tremendously good. I'm an avid hunter. I like duck hunting very much. I enjoy being out with my son and hunting very much. And so I enjoy hunting, I enjoy golf, but I enjoy getting out my morning jog. That's just something I enjoy, and I like to jog alone. I don't like to really jog with anyone else because it gives me a chance to think about the day and organize my thoughts and have a little downtime to myself mentally.
If you are elected governor of Tennessee, you've got a big job ahead of you. The state will be facing some cuts with no federal funds to really ease the blow. So knowing that, what do you hope to achieve as governor, and why are you the one for the job?
The state will be facing a smaller budget, as I said earlier, because these stimulus money will be going away and these one-time expenses will be going away. What I want to accomplish as governor is to put my jobs program on the table with the legislature and get that passed, because it's important to get people back to work. You know, I remind everybody as I travel around the state, 3 years ago when we had pretty much a good employment situation in this state, we had so much revenue that the legislature stayed in session for weeks arguing about how to spend the surplus. If we can get people back to work, then we'll have the revenue to move this state forward. And my very first priority is going to be to restore the rainy day fund, because we pulled down on that very responsibly, I think, because we're in a rainy day, no question about it. But then as we move forward and as we do have additional revenue, I want to look at lowering the sales tax on groceries, because that affects everybody across the board, rich and poor, young and old. I think it's very important that we be looking at those kind of programs.
Mike, thank you so much for inviting us into your home. This is truly a conversation that matters.
Oh, thank you, Vicki. I appreciate so much your being here.
Delighted to have you. Best of luck in the days ahead, too.
All right. Thank you.